YouTube. I watch a lot of fail videos on YouTube.
Oh, yeah.
check now.
I got a little bit.
Yeah, me too.
I got a little bit. Yeah. A little bit, but not enough.
The game.
Technically, it is 1 o'clock. Hey. Hi, guys.
Hey.
So, this is kind of basically the unofficial One Punch Man panel. I don't think it's advertised as such, though. Does it say One Punch Man panel, or does it just say our names?
We couldn't have it announced yet, remember?
That's right! You guys were One Punch Man! Well, he's One Punch Man.
Hey.
We're just the jerks that surround him in the show. We'll go down the line. Introduce yourselves, dudes.
Go ahead.
Hey, what's up? Yeah. I'm Zach Aguilar. I play Genos in One Punch Man.
Oh! Microphone! Is that the swine? That's the swine. Okay, cool.
Hey, I'm Max Mittelman. I play Saitama in One Punch Man.
Yeah.
Are we just talking about One Punch Man?
No, we can talk about whatever.
Alright, I'm gonna complete the list of credits. I also play Inaho in Alt Noah Zero. He's slain in Alt Noah Zero. I play Leo in Leo Caden Forest in Fire Emblem. I play King in Seven Deadly Sins.
Just get an IMDb. Come on, save these.
Okay, go.
What else do you do?
Thank you. I am Yoshida the Mimic in Blood Lad. I play, I'm really forgetting, I can't.
Well, what are we in together? I'm in Alt Noah Zero as well, as Count Mizurik. His name has two U's, I don't know. We're in Seven Deadly Sins together, all three of us. He plays King R, he was R the Print Dragon, he plays King, I play Guild Thunder. What else are we in? Let's do it while we're in together.
Oh, okay.
We're also in, are you in Durarara, Zach?
Nope.
I play Shijima in Durarara.
I play Randazumi in Durarara.
Shijima, the guy who scratches into his arm, musical staff.
Ew, that's disturbing. My guy has half a face, though, so that's not that bad. What else do we do together? Think, Google. Sword Art? Did we all do Sword Art?
Yeah.
We all did Sword Art.
Yeah. Sleeping Knights. Who are you?
Dr. AIDS.
Okay.
that's real. I got cast in that show as Dr. Kurihashi in the world's the most depressing, arguably, episode. I won't spoil it for you. But basically, I come in for two episodes and I'm just like, I hope you're having fun in Fantasy World, by the way. AIDS. And it's so depressing. I'm also a Mumen Rider in One Punch Man. I'm a cyclist.
And we forgot one. Gundam Iron Blooded Orphans.
Oh, are we all in that?
Yeah.
Oh, we're all in Gundam Iron Blooded Orphans.
I
play Guy Leo Baudouin. He's my little protege in that show.
Takaki on Earth.
I like it. It's beautiful out there. What else are we gonna get? We're doing a lot of stuff together, you guys. That's it. I think that covers it.
Yeah.
And I also on my own, I do Tuxedo Mask for Sailor Moon.
Yeah.
For those of you, I was here last year. I see some familiar faces. It's nice to see you. this is all the panelists. We're just gonna read our IMDb's together.
I'm in Boggy. I play Yunnan.
We do a bunch of video games and stuff. So we all do anime, games, some cartoons, all that good stuff, and this is a Q&A. So we are here to answer your One Punch questions. We're here to answer any questions you might have about the voiceover business, any personal questions you might have, as long as they're within the realms of PG-13, family-friendly. I'm cool to talk about that stuff. Let's do this. Who's got some questions? Let's do it.
Hands go up!
Yeah!
And they stay there!
Yeah!
What had a million views on YouTube?
Oh! What he was showing me... So that would be, 2009? That was 7 years ago, right when I was starting out to do some voiceover. I have a lit microphone, look.
Hello?
It's a short called Ducks Playing Duck Hunt. And it's two ducks who are playing Duck Hunt, sort of talking about, like, is it messed up that we're playing Duck Hunts? It's a 1 minute short, and it had a million views on you. I haven't seen that video since I've done it. I can't believe that's my buddy, Vernon. He's just my buddy. He's my godbabies. Father.
Let's list all the things that you put a duck in.
Oh, man. I don't know. I think a duck is my spirit animal. That's like the worst spirit animal.
He's in a show on Nickelodeon, which is just about ducks.
Yeah, Breadwinners. Yeah, yeah. I play a duck. That I played a duck.
I play a goose.
I'm in a Russian feature film called Quackers that I played the lead duck in. I can't get away from ducks, man. I don't know. Maybe one day I'll get to do one of them. It's really good ones.
Probably because you look...
I look like, do I look like a duck?
It's the bell.
You know what you guys should never do? You should never. No, you can. You should do that. You should never Google duck sexual practices. Don't ever do it. Yes, you should totally do it.
It's mating. You're talking about mating.
They're mating. It's a really weird part of nature.
Don't Google duck sexual practices.
Yeah, you should Google that. Yeah, it's really weird. I won't go into details, but it's super weird. Moving on. That's PG-13.
Yeah,
I didn't see any.
Yeah. Out of all the voices you've done, what was y'all guys' favorite one to do or favorite show to work on?
Genos.
Why?
Why? Because it's a freaking awesome show.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Robbie, go. I have to think.
Oh no! Not again. All right. Well, that's like asking someone to pick like their favorite pet or child.
But it still happens.
It's still happens. I feel bad for your other pets. I still got this microphone issue. Favorites. That's a tough one. What? Just an anime? Let me do just an
yeah,
let me
anime.
Do just anime. This is like a bad comedy routine. I would say my favorite in anime so far has been the Tuxedo Mask. Probably because it's what I've been doing the most. And he gives me an opportunity to do all the things that I like, which are to be dramatic, to be romantic, and to be super duper silly at the same time. So that's a role where you get to do all of those things. So I really enjoyed playing him. He's probably my favorite anime guy so far. But I'm sure, who knows what's down the pipe.
Yeah, it's funny because I would say Saitama so far is one of my faves, because you get to him, kind of like Robbie's character. He seems like a two-dimensional character. He seems like he's one note, but he does have levels, and he's with the changing, you know, animations of the show, his voice changes too, and it's kind of cool. I like that a lot. I like to be able to, you know, showcase that different side of him. So I'd say Saitama.
You gotta say Saitama.
Yeah.
This is a One Punch Man.
Yeah.
Does anybody have
duct tape?
A pocket knife? You shouldn't. Good. You do? Come bring me your fake pocket knife. That's not real. You're not real pocket knife.
Oh.
You know, it's totally illegal to carry a pocket knife. My grandpa told me that a man carries two things: a pocket knife and, oh my God, it's even like a functional pocket knife. Go ahead, ask the next question.
Yes. Yes.
And a walk.
Yes.
Just a question.
Yes, I saw your
hand.
I already asked you this one yesterday, but it's for everyone, I guess. Of your time recording sessions in, but anime, video games, whatnot, can you name...
Most interesting recording session?
Most interesting recording session, one of your best recording sessions, and one of your worst recording sessions.
Ooh. Best, worst, and most interesting recording session.
I know you can't say your best, because it's only a best.
Yes, Zach, go.
The best?
It's finally happened. I finally killed someone in a battle. You guys got an answer? I got an answer. My worst ever was a McDonald's commercial early in my career, probably right around Duck Hunt time, and I had two lines. It was like something to the extent of, "What would you like, sir?" And then the other line was like, "Sounds great, the cheeseburgers are awesome," or something equally dumb like that. And it took an hour to record. They had New York on the other line patched into the session, and I would do a line and be like, "Welcome to McDonald's, sir." And they'd go, "Thanks." I was like, are you kidding me? Like, it was the worst session. But then I came to learn that it probably wasn't me. It was probably a room full of advertisers and a room full of directors and engineers and all this stuff. So when you're new in the business, you kind of get it into your head that, you know, you're bad, no matter what. And whenever they talk about you on the other side of the glass because you can't hear them, what would you think? Obviously, they're talking about you and how much you suck. So, but at the same time, that was a really long time. Maybe I did suck. It's hard to say.
No, but I had a similar story, which I told yesterday. I'll tell it real quick, which I did a radio spot. I had two words. I had to say, I'm sorry. And that was it.
Mine was radio too.
I only had to say, I'm sorry. As in, someone said, and I didn't hear them, and I went, I'm sorry. And we did over 30 takes, and they ended up using the first take. and it was funny because the engineer kept muting them on the other end and playing little clips for me, like Justin Bieber, sorry, he would play that in my headphones, and he'd find lines from movies, and he'd find a line that was like, I'm sorry, okay? And he'd just play it for me.
That's great.
It was fun.
It's weird though, because I have a similar story about that too.
You were all just terrible.
No, it's doing all of those lines. I was doing like a dub of a Korean like live action film.
Dear God.
And basically there was this very, it was the last line in the session. Like it's almost over. I'm ready to go home. I'm like, yeah, we did. It was a good session. This one thing. I couldn't get it right, saying whirlpool. Whirlpool. Like a whirlpool, right? Like a whirlpool happened and it like changed something in the movie and they made me say whirlpool. Like, it was probably over 50 times.
Oh my gosh.
And they're just like, oh, no, like just another one. And then it got to the point like where they're just like, just give us like 20 in a row now. You know, after
that happens though, and that's different though, because it's sometimes as an actor, like you, in your head, you're like, I'm doing it exactly the way they're telling me to do it, but you're not. I mean, they hear it a certain way, and you're not giving it to them, and it can be so frustrating for both the actor and the director, because you both, you know, think that your way is right, and
you lose the sense of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. You cease to be objective once you repeat it. And whirlpools are tough because if you just say that whirlpool, it just loses all meaning.
Yeah. Whirlpool. Yeah.
I say words like experiment when it's supposed to be experiment.
He does say experiment. I've been in the room.
I say.
Yeah.
But it's when they use the second take. That's when.
Yeah, he's crazy. Trying to get in your head. Well, didn't you also ask a two-parter though? Didn't you ask?
Yeah, the worst, the best, and the worst. Interesting.
Probably like most interesting or strange.
Some of the most. I don't know if I can think of a specific one, but I think some of the most interesting ones for me are when I have smaller parts, where I'm not doing as much heavy lifting and I'm in a room with other actors. I really enjoy kind of being a fly on the wall and learning and watching. My peers and people I look up to work. Those for me are definitely the most interesting sessions, because when you're kind of in the work, like doing it, if you're in it, it's hard to be objective and step back. But when you're a supporting role or a smaller part, you can watch these other people work, and that's always my favorite. I love the days where I'm the lead, but I also love to sort of watch other people I respect.
Favorite story.
Favorite story?
Like an interesting experience or a unique experience.
Well, I told this one yesterday. It's not really like it's kind of funny. You guys know how Chris like has the soda thing going on? Like the weird soda stuff?
Okay. Yeah.
Well, anyways, so I told this thing yesterday. Basically, while I was recording for Genos, we're doing, you know, the Sea King stuff, right? Fighting Sea King, an intern brings in like this peanut butter and jelly flavored soda, like a six pack of these sodas, right? And so some people are like, oh wow, that must have been really good, right?
No.
So here's your mayonnaise soda.
here's the thing though. This is so basically, you know, like I'm kind of focused on what we're doing. It's like a fight scene or whatever, and I have my headphones on. I'm looking at the screen, and I'm ready to do the next line and the next scene, and I look through the glass and I look and I see like Chris's. I look and see Chris's face, and he's like drinking, you know, the soda, and he's like. You know, and so then he goes, then he, you know, gives some to the engineer. The engineer drinks it, just like, he's just like, it's like disgusting. And so, you know, obviously, because, you know, they pushed a little, the little intercom button so that I can hear what they're actually saying through their headphones, they didn't push it at all. So I'm looking through the glass, and that's all I see in complete silence. And so I see them doing that. And so then Chris finally, like, realizes, oh, crap, like, Zach's like, he doesn't know, like, you know, like, he pushes it. Okay, so this is what's going on. We have this peanut butter and jelly soda, and it's god-awful. He said it tastes like lake water, lake or bath water, and like licking some old grandmother's couch, right? Nothing, no peanut butter and jelly at all. It just tastes terrible. And so he's like, you've got to try some of this. This is going on like while we're doing the session.
It's like the Birdie Bot's vomit flavor beans, jelly beans.
It's like, oh, it's disgusting, you got to try it.
Did you think they were making the retching noises at like your performance?
Oh, yeah.
That's what I thought you were telling story.
No.
You looked over there just like, oh.
It was so strange to me too until, you know, I saw the soda and I was like, oh, like, and then he's like holding it up and looking at it. So I'm like, okay, it's the soda, I think. So Chris like comes in, he pours me like a cup of it and I drink a little bit of it. It's like the most disgusting thing I've ever tasted in my life.
You know what's great is cucumber soda.
I've heard
it's refreshing.
I've heard that it's good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's take another question. We just don't talk about sodas that way. Sir.
What can you tell us, if anything, on Saturday's One Punch episode? What's coming up?
Well, I get, you know, well, who's seen it already in Japanese? A lot of you. Yeah, that's what I figured, because it's been out for a little while, so yeah. there's no real spoilers, but we won't get heavy spoilers for anything coming up. I mean, that's your episode, man. Take it away.
You know, like, if you watch the last episode, you know, you can see Genos, like, walking through a field of, like, dead cows or something, and so, you know, and, like, obviously that's when mosquito monster appears. Yeah.
Mosquito girl.
Yes, and Genos also.
You guys know Christina V, who is here. She's gonna be Mosquito Girl.
Yeah. Really, really good.
Yeah. And I'm the nameless punk that she kills first.
Yeah,
it's something like it's something like, oh yeah, it's so.
Wait, that's you?
Yeah. Yeah, he's like, it's so easy to rob people because everyone's running away. Who's this? he gets drained. That's no spoiler. They let us do bloopers every once in a while. So he has this moment where Mosquito Girl flies past and his hat flies off his head and kind of just goes in the distance, just looks at it, and I was just like, Wilson! I named my hat Wilson. There's a lot of stuff coming. It's basically Genos' backstory episode. Do we get to meet Dr. Bad Guy?
No.
I don't know. There's so many characters.
No.
Nope.
I think that's episode 3.
Okay. There you go. Gorilla Todd?
I am Gorilla Man.
What is it?
Gorilla. Somebody knows.
Armored Gorilla.
I like Cyber Gorilla.
Yeah.
No, that's not that episode because. No, that can't be that episode.
No, wait.
That's the episode where Saitama
is. No, it is that episode.
I think it's that episode.
No, literally all happens in that one episode.
What? Yeah. Yeah.
Come
on,
and then you fight.
You guys, we don't know what's gonna happen! Watch the show!
Toonami. It's gonna be good. I saw your hand up.
Yeah.
Yes.
Sorry, I came here late.
What?
Anime Idol is happening.
Don't apologize.
So if you could write an episode of One Punch Man, how would it go? Question for all three.
Ooh, that's a great question.
Wanna workshop this right now?
Yeah, let's work it out. Hurry up. Put the post-it notes out. Stick it up.
I think it would start with Saitama. He'd wake up. Mm-hmm. Wake up and he'd go, oh, just another boring day. And then, you know, he'd look out his window, nothing's happening, turn on the news, nothing's happening. When, you know, goes to brush his teeth, walks outside, all of a sudden,
oh no! All the exposition and all the action to me. All of a sudden, he looks to his left on the balcony, and there's Genos doing his laundry for him. On an old school washboard. Why are they using that? I don't know. It's Japan. Weird stuff happens. And they're together, and Saitama's sipping his tea in the morning, and he looks over at Genos, and they both just nod at each other at their awkward relationship. And then off in the distance, lightning cracks. In a volcano erupts!
After the volcano erupts, this big.
I give you volcano erupts and after it erupts!
After the volcano erupts, this gigantic molten lava man.
Yes?
That's a villain, obviously, comes out of the volcano.
Uh-huh.
And he starts. Freaking like he's able to he's like a freaking like lava bender and he's like the lava bender riding the lava, the wave of the lava, it's going down the volcano.
It's just crashing into the city below, melting the buildings below. Thousands of people are perishing. And then Saitama, his spidey sense goes off. He tingles.
And he does the sound of you.
And then Genos looks over at him and he says, are you finished with your tea yet? And he goes, no, do you want to get this one? And he says, yeah, now's my chance. And Genos goes out to fight the lava monster and he does what's your big special move with the fire? What's it called?
Incinerate.
Incinerates! But it only makes the lava monster stronger.
Absorbs the explosion.
Yeah.
And he gets bigger.
And tougher.
Bigger.
And stronger.
And then on the screen it just goes to be continued.
But then after the credits preview, Saitama punches him and it ends the episode.
Yeah, that's over. Done and done.
Yeah.
All right. Anybody else? Who's got questions? Ooh, right there.
Can you do the voice for King?
Sure.
Does King have a call out?
Yeah. Deanne!
That's good. Does King Arthur have a call out?
No.
All right, fine. I was going to try to get us all to do call outs, but if we don't have one.
What's yours?
Lightning King Ironhammer! I don't know what that means.
Oh, yeah. But I can't remember what it is. It's like.
Chesty full!
Chesty full?
Yeah, that's his spear is called.
Oh, chesty full? Like a chesty full?
Not chesty. Gold?
Not like
chesty.
A chesty. Like,
yeah, it's his pillow.
Chesty full. Chesty full.
I didn't mean his.
Not his. Never mind. What?
Anyway,
breakout role. The role that made
you big. The Poltergeist. I'm still waiting. The Poltergeist! Yes, the Breadwinners.
When I first met Robbie, was on his show Breadwinners, and I played a character called the Poltergeist. And the breakdown was really annoying goose who was a mix between Steve Urkel and the Crypt Keeper. So
the Poltergeist sounded like this, and he went, huh?
Like that was the whole thing. Show.
Yeah, I like that episode. That's a good one.
It's one of the games, I think Gary's and Steve said it was one of their favorites.
Yeah, that's a good one. Walter Goose is solid. That's not a good
answer. It's no, no, it's not.
In the anime world, mine's easy. My first anime was Sailor Moon, so that's easy for me. Yeah. That was, but I'm still waiting to be big. When's that happen? What do you think for you? Your line?
For me? I guess so. Yeah, your line kind of took me to a few conventions. So your line, April. Yeah.
Right. And what about you? Gotta be
Genos.
Yeah. It's not even out yet.
It's gotta be all known for you, right?
Yeah, all known was the first breakout role, I would say.
So. Yeah, because you won. you did a bunch of stuff, like the traditional route, but you won the Bang Zoom
voice actor
thing, right?
Yeah, I did the open auditions at Anime Expo in 2014, and that's how I started getting into voicing anime.
And then they kind of put you through the tests of what, Walla and small
characters? I did Walla for Kill la Kill and Gargantia, and then I moved Magi stuff. Like incidentals, and then after that,
you got your old number.
Yeah.
Those were real answers to your question. How about that? And Poltergeist. It's good. It's good.
Yes. Any others? Any others?
We got 30 more minutes of Q&A, and you better start thinking about some cues.
Yeah.
I don't know if somebody's asked already, but can you guys sing the One Punch Man opening? You can beatbox if you want to beatbox.
Yes!
I don't know anything but the part.
Go ahead.
Saw them do that live. It was really.
Yeah, they were awesome.
They were awesome.
Yeah,
I was stoked about it. They were great. Mm-hmm. They were like, they must have been around for a while. They're like
Japanese Bruce Springsteen.
Yeah, they're more like Aerosmith maybe.
Yeah,
they're
like
Japanese Aerosmith.
Those guys were rocking out.
They were awesome.
So there you go. Munch.
You guys. Yeah.
Yes. Do you guys have any pets? What a question!
No, it's awesome. Yeah. I have a cat named Link and a dog named Zelda.
Aww.
That went over just as I planned.
Oh man. I don't personally have a pet. My parents have a dog named Haley.
Aww.
It's a little Yorkie.
Aww.
It only has 3 legs and 1 eye. Not really, that's not true.
Yeah, I have 2 cats and a dog. My dog is Sheltie. So like the little Lassie dog. And then I have a cat that's like a Bengal. Like he's like looks like a little tiger. And then my other cat's just an alley cat, little black cat. It's nice.
You guys, we're so good with pets.
Yeah.
Yes.
So what's the difference, performance-wise, for doing a regular, American-made cartoon versus a dubbed Japanese or Korean or whatever cartoon?
I think, well, the major difference is that when we do original animation, we don't have the animations for us there. When we're dubbing, it's all done in Japanese, so all we do, I don't want to downplay it, but they play us the Japanese right there on a screen, and then they take out the Japanese voices, and they just kind of just mute it for us and play it, and we have to match the lip sync. But when you're doing original animation, it's kind of like shooting a TV show. They give you the script, the only difference is you're in a studio, you're behind a mic, and you go down the lines, you read your lines, but you don't get to see this anything. Most times you don't get to see a storyboard or, yeah.
If you're doing a new show, you might not even know exactly what your character's going to look like or how they're going to behave. And then in the end, in what we call prelay, in traditional sort of American cartoons that are being produced here, then they'll animate to us. So they'll use our performance to create the animations of the characters. And if you're doing a film, they might film you with a camera from a couple of angles and use your expressions in the digital animation, if it's digital. Usually that's something they don't do in 2D cartoons. And also in 2D cartoons, you'll normally be recording with someone else. So if you're working with someone, you'll run down the whole script. So instead of an anime where you're just doing your lines, you're working a scene, a page or 2 or 3 at a time when you're doing a cartoon. You may go back and do what we call pickups and get a few lines a little bit more precise for what they're looking for, but those are the major differences. I don't know if anybody was at my Q&A yesterday, but I made this analogy then. It's like the difference between me handing you a blank sheet of paper, and let's say you're a painter, and I say, paint me a landscape. whatever you want, or paint me a landscape of the ocean. And then, that's traditional animation. And then if I hand you a paint by numbers of the ocean, that might be more than you would have to equate to anime, where there's a much tighter framework there. You'll have room to interpret. You might draw me a really awesome paint by numbers, but it's still gonna be the paint by numbers. Yeah, so that's my analogy. Paint by numbers? Did you remember paint by numbers?
Yes.
It's like a coloring book and it's got numbers in it.
Oh, you're
and
talking
the numbers.
About...
That's nuts, connected to us.
Oh, like the coloring.
You guys, like 14 is like fuchsia, and you go
right.
Do whatever, and then each one has a thing, and then you end up, and it's a framework like a coloring book.
It's an excellent analogy.
Thank you. I just came up with it this weekend.
Okay, yeah. So there you go. It's pretty much
the difference.
Okay, so are there any animes that they haven't started doing dubs for yet that you kind of want to go into?
I want to do one's other series.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I don't think I think it might be
really cool.
I think it might have gone. It might not be LA. I think it might have gone to Funny, but that's just a rumor. I have no idea yet. I don't even know if it's licensed yet. It's still super new, right? I'd love to get my hands on that one. Unlikely since we're doing this, but possible. I would definitely do that one. What else is coming out that's not dubbed yet? I wanted to be in Tokyo Ghoul, but that also got dubbed in Texas.
Yeah.
And the cast ended up being great. I've done a few cons with Austin, and I think he does a really good job with that, and everybody else in the cast. That's a really good dub. Yeah. It's tough for us, because like, if we see something we're interested in, it's like, where's it going? Is it going to LA or Texas?
Yeah.
We got at least we got a shot if it's in LA. But if it's in Texas, unless you had sort of a pre-existing relationship with Funimation before you moved to LA, you're probably not going to be flying down there to do stuff. So,
yeah.
What do you guys? You guys see anything lately you might want to be in?
I haven't. I mean, aside from, ones.
Yeah. What's that thing called?
Mob Psycho 100.
That's it. Yeah.
There's a Pokemon nearby.
Think of a day? No.
All right.
No.
That's
fine. Yeah.
Well, actually, wait. No. Well, that's the thing, though. I don't think it's ever gonna get dubbed, though. But I really like Nisekoi.
Oh.
I thought that was really cool. But I know that they already have they already have the sub DVDs, whatever. So I don't think it's gonna.
What
get
a
dubbed.
Weeb.
Sad.
Anyway, any other questions?
Yeah, let's do it.
Oh, do that.
Two.
What voice actors inspired you to actually become voice actors?
She's a stolen question.
It's okay, you can ask it too.
All right.
I'll start with Zach.
Go.
You go first, Zach. Attack.
Okay. Just kind of getting into anime, I really liked Naruto. So, Yuri Lowenthal was one.
Yeah!
And then I also liked, Bleach and stuff like Code Geass. So, Jiang Yang-bosh was another really big inspiration to me.
I have a huge list.
Endless. Probably overlap with what you might say. But I was into the OG voice actors, the Dawes Butler, Mel Blanks, Frank Welker, Dee Bradley Baker. I'm moving into more new, but there was Dee Baker, there was Rob Paulsen, there was Fred Tatasciore, there was Steve Bloom. The list goes on. I was saying yesterday, like anybody who did anything, I was way into. I was an instant fan of anybody who was. Had voice acted in anything that I ever watched.
That list that you did, that's a lot of my. We wouldn't be doing a lot of this without Mel Blanc and all of his Looney Tunes stuff. Same list for me. And as you go on, you get to work with these people, and that's part of the neatest part of it. Even if it's only for a day or two or a few sessions. And those are those moments for me where I'm like, this is great, And as I'm sure with you, now you've done shows with Johnny and all that stuff, and
yeah.
It's that kind of moment's really neat. For me, it was Rob Paulson, who you mentioned. If I had to single one person's career out, I like all these people and I respect them a ton. But Rob Paulson, you know, I don't know if you know of his work, but he was like Brain in
Pinky.
Or not Pinky, or Pinky and Pinky in the Brain. He was Yakko in the Animaniacs. He was one of the original Ninja Turtles. He's now one of the current. He's now Donatello on the current Nickelodeon Ninja Turtles. He just has this huge, long career, and not only that, but he's like the nicest guy. He's funny, he's talented, and he has a very unique voice. So I feel like I hear him in all his characters, but all of his characters are so different and so unique. And he started out doing young guy stuff. And if I had a career that I would love to emulate for my own, it would be something like, he's almost 60 now and he's a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle. That gives hope to us young voiced guys as we go through our career. So for me, he's a really big inspiration. And he's, all that list, I've worked with everybody who's still alive in that list that you mentioned, except for Rob. I've never done a session with him. I'm waiting. I just wanna hang out and work with him. He's the one I haven't worked with. Yeah. And someday it'll happen. Yeah. Yeah. Good question. You had a question though, right?
Is there like a specific like anime that you're really, really, really into, or a TV animated show that you're into?
I'll tell you, like, when I was growing up, I watched a lot of Fullmetal Alchemist.
Yeah!
And Rurouni Kenshin. Those are some of my favorites. I think they still are. I can still watch those and enjoy them, you know. Now, shows now? There's a lot. I mean, can't think of any, but there's a lot.
I don't watch as much anymore for pleasure. So when you work, you know what? I don't as much currently.
I don't have cable, so
that's a problem. Cutting the cord.
But I love shows like Adventure Time. What else is out there? I like Steven Universe.
Yes.
I like Breadwinner.
No.
Yeah. What do you like, Zach?
Yeah, like Adventure Time, regular show. Gosh.
She said anime.
What anime?
What anime? You did too? Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh. What's it called? Star versus the Forces of Evil.
Oh yeah, great show.
Yeah, that was a great show. Yeah.
Akora was a great show.
Akora, yes. What else, like, for anime? I already kind of listed some.
What's your favorite anime? One anime is tops it all. If you were stranded on a desert island with rations, but all you had was one DVD, which anime would it be from?
Gosh. It's weird, like I...
No, just choose...
Where were the set of parameters for you when you answered the question?
I don't know. Nobody gave me any, so I figured, why not?
You can't, I don't know. I really like, Dragon Ball Z and...
Dragon Ball Z?
That's your answer, Dragon Ball Z!
Yeah.
That's your answer.
Okay, Dragon Ball Z, yeah.
Alright, what's next? What do we get?
You must have a question.
I don't.
It's Max, isn't it? Look at that silky skin. It's wet. It's the Florida humidity. So you say.
This one's for all of you. All right. Would you rather fight one duck? One horse-sized duck. Goddamn, the ducks, again.
No, Robbie, what is
it? It's one horse-sized duck or 100 duck-sized horses.
All of you.
I would rather fight... I'd rather fight the horse-sized duck. I'm ready for it. Which is basically a dinosaur. But I kind of feel like I might be able to take that dinosaur. Yeah, yeah, that's my answer.
I would do the 100 duck-sized horses, because it would be like fighting the mole man. It would be like Saitama, just be like, ba ba ba, ka, and it would be super easy and simple. I'd just kick him with that.
No, man.
I'd tame that.
A swarm of them?
I know. What if they all like swarm you and like kill you that way? Like
a swarm of them? Like, I have fast reef. I'm small. I have fast reef.
You can't take them all, though.
No, you can't take them all.
Ooh!
Boom!
Incinerate!
Executive normal punches.
What about you, Zach?
Yeah, probably the horse-sized duck, I think.
Yeah.
Demystic! Valor.
You had a bastion.
Valor.
Oh, me?
You did have one. If you're trying to renege on your previous question, I'm not gonna allow it. What was your question?
I was gonna say, if any of you could work on Pokemon, would you?
If we could work on Pokemon, would we?
Yeah.
I think so, sure. They record most of the Pokemon stuff in New York. Yeah,
I'm
yeah.
gonna be one of the new Sun and Moon Pokemon.
Yeah.
Yes.
What's it called?
Mimikyu?
Yeah.
Mimikyu.
Yeah.
I'll voice Mimikyu.
Yeah.
Put in the call.
Mimikyu.
I want to be the one that's just a lei, like a Hawaiian lei.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's
flower
like
crop.
It's like aloha or something.
It's, like
it's pretty funny. It's pretty funny.
How would that sound if you could voice it right now? How does he?
What are his efforts?
I have no idea. This is like brand new. Yeah. I just saw it on my Facebook
workshop
feed.
Workshop this.
I don't want to workshop anything else with you today.
Yeah.
Who would you be? Would you go and do Pokemon?
Oh, hell yeah.
Yeah. Heck yeah.
Heck yeah.
Pika.
Other questions? Put them up. Who hasn't asked one? Have you asked one?
No.
Yeah.
What are the other answers to the one favorite anime on a deserted island?
Oh! That's easy for me. Ninja Scroll, the feature film. I would take Ninja Scroll. That was like the anime where I first understood what anime was, I think. And then I found anime through films, so like renting them at my local video rental place when that was still a thing that you could do. I rented Ninja Scroll, and I went right from Ninja Scroll to Akira, and then I don't think Metropolis was out yet. That was 2001, but then I found the films, and then I was like, oh, Toonami, what is that? And then I kind of got into DBZ like in my college years and stuff like that. Yeah.
I say Cowboy Bebop.
Because not only is it a badass anime, it's got great music, so I could jam out to that.
Gosh. Like another anime on the desert island? It's weird, like I was gonna say Death Note, but there's this one show I really liked. I just remembered, I watched it on Netflix not too long ago. It was called Kenichi, The Mightiest Disciple.
Yes.
That show is so cool. Like every single time he had a fight, I mean, I don't know, if I was on a desert island, I feel like I'd want to get in shape or something. So when they finally rescue me, you know, I'll just be like, ugh! And yeah, I don't know, that show really pumped me up. Really,
really cool. Yeah, you go full Tom Hanks. Is that two Castaway jokes?
Yeah.
In one panel?
There it is. There it is.
Nice.
Can we go for three?
Well, we're going to see. Keep the questions coming.
The questions should be tailored around the water and movies, so.
I don't really do that.
Did you play volleyball?
I played volleyball.
Yeah, me too. I live near the beach, so I played, beach volleyball.
Wilson.
Yeah, Wilson.
No. You know they actually, you know, like make that volleyball, right?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, and then you can buy it. I want one. It's got the little.
We did an episode of Breadwinners where my little sidekick, Badoose, gets gets recruited by Steven Quackberg to do a new movie.
Oh, gross.
And it's just called Volleyball the Movie. And he's going to be the star of it, but then he finds out that he's cast as the volleyball. He's just getting like beaten up by these big like Tom Cruise characters like playing beach volleyball.
Very circular.
It was a funny episode. Question? Yes?
Do you find it harder to watch anime now that y'all guys have done it for so long? Do it every day?
I like, it's weird. For me, I feel like working on anime has made me even pickier about the stuff I watch and like what I spend my time like actually watching. Because beforehand, I used to just like pretty much watch like, you know, a lot of the shows and go down them even if they weren't maybe like the most interesting things ever. But now, I mean, the show has to be like, you know, like really freaking cool for me to like actually go through and watch the entire thing. So
it's kind of voicing things now. Maybe not specifically anime, but a lot of games that I play, I'll have a tendency to listen to the voices really closely, and it kind of takes me out of the immersive experience that a video game should be. Because I'll be like, you know, either I'll be trying to figure out the voice actor, or, you know, be really happy about the performance, or really mad at the performance. But yeah, other than, yeah, it's a lot of times I'll watch something and it kind of distracts me. Or I'll be watching a movie or a TV show, and I'm like, they 8-yard that line. Yeah. And I can't get out of my head, and I just enjoy the entertainment that I'm watching.
Yeah, yeah, why did the main character say, look, it's a boat, in the cutaway?
Because
you know there was some editor going, I don't think they're going to get that there's a boat out there. I was like, get him in the studio.
Yeah.
That's very similar. I don't feel like it makes me more judgy necessarily, but I do, sometimes I will listen to things and go, oh man, yeah, I don't know if I can watch this. Or, and it's not just anime, it's, you know, commercials in the car. That's like,
oh yeah,
my girlfriend's here, she'll attest to it. She'll just be, we'll just be riding in the car, and I'll be like, oh God, turn this commercial. She's like, why? It's a Pepsi commercial. Like, I can't listen to it. It's terrible. You know, but I'm not really that way so much with things like games. We all play Overwatch, but Zach plays on PC, right?
Master Race.
Yeah, PC Master Race. But Max and I play on PS4 together. And we have friends in the cast. So like Matt Mercer is like a buddy of mine. So you know, he plays McCree, and you know his call. And what does everybody help me with it?
It's time.
So every time that happens, I'm like, oh, God, Mercer! They're like, every time we kill him.
That's all we say too. We go, Mercer's coming, Mercer's coming!
Like, we don't even refer to him as McCree. And then Torbjorn is our buddy Keith Silverstein. So we were out at a party at AX and we're like, Keith. Say, what is it?
I full-on geeked out on him, and he was like, stop. and I was like, Keith, please say, come get your armor. And he was like, no.
And then he waited 5 seconds and went, come get your armor.
Yeah. He like whispered in my ear, he's like, come get your armor.
Yeah, but most of the time if I'm playing something AAA or I'm watching something like a cartoon, I'm like, yes, oh, sweet, so-and-so got that. Because now I feel like I have a pretty good ear. I can pick out, you know, 8 out of 10 people that I hear, and then if I hear somebody really unique, I'm like, oh, who is that? And then I'll get on IMDb and be like, oh, sweet, you know, because sometimes it'll be a camera actor who doesn't do much voiceover, or somebody they're allowing to do something out of the box that, like, oh, I didn't, you know, I might hear Zach, and I'd be like, I didn't know Zach could do a funny old lady, you know, and you know, you never know.
NBA.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
NBA is so sorry, dude. Yeah.
Yeah, you have any bad experiences at any of the conventions?
Well, what
bad
experiences.
Bad con experiences.
Yeah, yes.
Ooh.
Yeah. There's so many. Let me just list down all the conventions I hate. And see, there's this one and this one. I'll probably never get invited back there again.
The fear and loathing guy.
Yes. Oh, thank you. I was like, who knew that? Who knew that? I was like, oh, wait, it's my girlfriend. Oh God, the fear. There was this guy cosplaying. You know, Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. Yeah. He was cosplaying the Hunter S. Thompson character, but he was like fully dedicated to the role, and he might have also been fully dedicated to the role. He was so uncomfortable. He was following guests and like, and not like a, hey, can we take a picture and chat with you for a second? It was like, I'm like full character all the time. Like, hey, what are you doing? And then he would come to my panels and just say random BS out of nowhere. Until it got to day two, I find it's the only time I've ever done this. I had to go to like con security and be like, hey guys, I'm cool with it. If he touches me, I'm gonna lay him out. But I have a feeling he's making other guests uncomfortable. And then they went around and asked the other guests, and he was going to everyone's thing and being disruptive. And it's just so weird, because like, we're all here to have fun and like dress up and hang out, but there's a certain level you can't take it to, and that guy had went over the edge with it. That was the only really negative experience I've ever had.
What about that one?
This happened the other day. He was great. Not so negative, just so weird, but so great.
Wait a second.
Can you rewind it?
Yeah.
Show us.
Put it in the microphone. Write it up. This guy, who just came out of nowhere. I'm so.
You got us taken off.
Yeah. And I would, but before this moment happened, he came up and just went. And I know he was doing a character, but it went on for like a minute too long. When I was like, "Cool, man, that's hilarious. What's your cosplay?" It's like, no. Quick, let's go get some food.
You are made of the stuff of nightmares!
He was alright. He was having a good time. Yeah, he was fine. It was just super weird. What about you guys? Anything bad? I had a girl go face down, butt up, right in front of my autograph session once.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. She just went, how are you? The lights out. She was so sweet. Everybody helped her up. She was fine. She just, I think she maybe stood in line a little too long with her knees locked up and walked up to.
Yeah, I don't really have
to. Yeah, nobody's gotten too weird yet.
Same here.
Yeah, but this is sort of your first year doing the con circuit, right? Yeah, don't worry, you'll have plenty of weird stories. Yeah. We like to keep it positive here. Put that hand up. You got your questions.
Put it up. Be careful.
Put it up. You're doing great. That was a fantastic question.
That was a great
question.
And you
did great.
Yes. What made us get into to voice acting? I like to say that I first started voice acting on Xbox Live when I was when I was 12 years old. You know, I would get on with a headset and play Halo and pretend that I was a different person than I was. So I'd pretend I was from England or Australia or some other country, and the job was convince the other person that I am from that place and I'm not actually just a little white boy from
Calabasas.
That was the first thing. But I didn't know voice acting was a thing, was a profession, was a career I could choose. And the thing that made me want to do it, my brother was driving in Burbank, California, and he passed by this this place called Calmanson & Calmanson, which is like a casting / educational facility. And he got a card, and he came home, he gave me a card. This was, I was 18, and I was like, what's this? He's like, it's something called voiceover. And I was like, voiceover? I don't have any clue what that is. And there was a class starting the next day. I took the class. When they told me what voiceover was, I was like, oh,
you mean it's talking like this and all I have to do is go, hi, I'm so-and-so from such-and-such. And
I don't know, I had a very weird, skewed vision of what voiceover was supposed to be. But after that, after I took that class, I was like, yeah, this is what I want to do for my profession. And then I was pre-med for 4 more years.
So. It's weird, I kind of like, a similar story with the whole Xbox thing. I used to play a lot, I was the 12-year-old that would, you know, scream into the headset. But it's weird though, because I was actually good at the game that I played. I played a lot of Pokemon.
What are you saying?
Yeah, the only difference is I was actually good at the game.
I was good at the game. I'm just saying.
I didn't suck.
No, he wasn't saying you sucked. He was saying that the typical 12-year-old who screams into the microphone.
Right. Sure.
Yeah. I like to take everything personally though.
Well, quiet. Let's just spin the ball. No, I'm kidding. Make it weird. Yeah.
I would play a lot, and I would go play with like these older guys and like people who were, you know, really high levels and stuff, and try to do tournaments and whatnot for Halo. And so basically, you know, because I was a young boy,
and like I was like this, you know, and everything that I said was super high and whatever, and I'm just like, hey, what's up, guys?
And so, you know, it was really weird. And so what I did is, oh, hey guys, what's going on? Yeah, we're playing Halo. Oh yeah, okay, cool. Let's get it going. And
you know, like I would just kind of like, I would put the mic like really close to my face, and I would like kind of like lower my voice a bit in pitch, and just kind of like, and try to like hang out with them, and pretty much like, you know, like they'd be like, oh cool, like how old are you? Okay, you know, like 18.
And I was like, I don't know, I think when I was doing that stuff though, I was like 13 or 14, my voice had kind of changed a bit, so I was like experiencing with the pitch stuff. I had no idea really what voice acting stuff was. I like SpongeBob though. SpongeBob was cool. So, I don't know, that was pretty much it. That was like how I guess, discovered really like doing voices and kind of like acting and pretending like I was somebody else through a microphone to a bunch of random, like, random dudes playing Halo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sweet.
Yeah.